Testament, when somebody was anointed, they poured oil on their head, signifying that they were receiving the Spirit of God. So we have five of them that had the lamps with no oil, but five of them had the lamps with the oil. And it says, while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. Now, if we look in Luke 18, we get a little bit of, I think it's Luke 4:18. It talks a little bit about the Spirit. Jesus quotes from Isaiah, and it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those that are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And when Jesus said this, he closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. He was teaching in the synagogue, and it says the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. They were mesmerized. The Spirit was coming upon them, I think, or at least resonating in their hearts. And he began to say to them, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. He said this very important scripture of the Old Testament from 1,000 years before was being fulfilled right before their eyes. And realize that the Bible tells us that 1,000 years is a day to God. And I think the world today, very often, we kind of think, well, you know, that old Bible is just so old, you know? And it was written, you know, almost 2,000 years ago, the most recent parts of it, and some of it 3,000, maybe 3,500 years ago. Well, to God, that was like day before yesterday and maybe going back as far as Wednesday or Thursday. Okay? We have to take the eternal view. So we get the temporal view. That is, we see based on what we can see in front of us and what we're going to do the next week or the next day. This up-and-coming generation, they say really the next 15 minutes. I mean, things are changing at lightning speed, and we don't think in these long-term, what's long-term to us. Revelations, however, speaks to time that is occurring now, I believe, and will be occurring in the near future, a lot of it. So it's not just talking about what happened back at Adam and Eve. It's not just talking about back in Moses' day. It's talking about now. And as we study the Bible, we see that the continuity, we see the thread that connects us with all of these important things that have happened and will happen. In Revelations 19, it says in verse 5, then a voice came from the throne saying, praise our God, all you his servants and those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters and as the sound of mighty thundering, saying, alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. We're back to a wedding ceremony. And that wedding ceremony is Christ returning for his church. The church is described over and over as the bride that will be presented pure and righteous to Christ. That's why we focus on identity so much, because we are the church, not just us gathered here at Archie's, but believers in many congregations across this land and throughout the world, and those that aren't in a congregation, perhaps there's no legal church or they're not don't have access to a church, but they're believers. They're part of the body of Christ, collectively referred to as the bride of Christ. That's how much Christ loves us. And the bridegroom is not going to leave the bride at the altar. We see that. We just read, blessed are those invited to the wedding, believers. So this is what Jesus is talking about in Matthew 25 in this parable of the 10 virgins. And behold, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Now remember, they'd fallen asleep. And the church today, in many cases, is falling asleep. We get sidetracked. We forget our purpose. We forget our goal. And we get caught up, I hate to say it, in little, you know, personal agendas and, you know, our own little area of influence, things that we want to be in control of. And even, believe it or not, personality conflicts, things that have nothing to do with serving our Lord. But the call went out at midnight. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should not be enough for us and you, but rather go out to those who sell and buy for yourselves. Remember, oil represents spirit. We need to be filled with the Spirit. We need the Spirit of God, or we're not going to be focused on things of the Spirit, are we? It's in the flesh that we get sidetracked. It's in the flesh that we forget about focusing on Christ, except for maybe some lip service. It's in the flesh that we start focusing on works and forget about our identity. And when we focus on works, we start making it about us, seeking affirmation rather than believing in the affirmation Christ has already given us, seeking attention from others rather than focusing on God. When we're walking in the Spirit, we don't need all that pat on that back and the gold stars Dave talks about and that attention, because we're in the Spirit. That joy wells up within us. That living water that gives life. But here's the deal. You can't give your spirit to somebody else, and nobody can give that spirit to you. As a preacher I heard once say, there's people that want to stand next to your fire. Yeah, they want that positive energy that they sense. And some people will take the next step, and they will seek it for themselves from God where they can get it. But there's others that, for whatever reason, they don't cross that threshold. And they want to be near you. And they want to hear good news. And they want to get pumped up. And they want to be told everything's going to be all right. And they want to be told that God loves them, and he does. But they never give their heart to God. You can't fill them up. Share with them, love them, but if you haven't given your heart to God, if you haven't accepted Christ as your Savior, nobody else can do that for you. Well, my mom was a good Christian. Good for her. Or my grandfather, he was a great Christian. He took me to church when I was little. Wonderful. But do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior today? Today is the acceptable day for salvation. Why do you think Jesus is telling us what is coming? He wants us to be ready. He wants us to be like the five virgins that had oil in their lamps. They were ready. And let's see what happens with them, those that were ready. And while they went to buy, see, while they went off looking for it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. They got in. They were in with the bridegroom. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. He's coming back. Luke, Dr. Luke, writes in chapter 12, he quotes Jesus, verse 35, Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning, and you yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he will return from the wedding, and when he comes and knocks, they may open to him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. Assuredly, I say to you, that he will gird himself and have them sit down to eat, and will come and serve them. And if he should come in the second watch or come in the third watch, meaning if he comes in the wee hours of the morning when we least expect, and find them, blessed are those servants. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you don't expect. The world's not expecting him to come back. To the world, to the secular world, you know what we are? Christian myth advocates. How's that? That's what academia terms believers. We're just another religious fringe out there. Jesus told us the world would grow cold. Men's hearts would grow cold. But he's telling us we need the oil. We need the Spirit. He said if it was possible in that day, even the elect would be deceived. The deception will be that strong. Many are being deceived today. I think this up-and-coming generation faces even more stronger, worse challenges than our generation. We have some understanding as a generation. We have something we can go back to. But if you don't even know what's in the Bible, if you don't even know what Scripture is, except what Hollywood portrays on some sitcom mocking Christians, then they're in a vacuum. Let not our vessels, let not us be in a vacuum. Let's be filled with the Spirit. And we do that by allowing Him to fill us.
Thank you, sir. All right. Good job, Bob. Thank you. Okay, so in the way of review, Bob spoke about the oil being the Holy Spirit, like the Holy Spirit. We're going to start at the very top. I like your little play on gut milk. Gut spirit. With the Spirit is life and life eternal, according to the Scripture. Life and liberty. And our performance, the best we get out of it, is death. It says the letter of the law brings death, but the Spirit brings life and liberty. And what that talks about is our performance, our attempts to build our stairway to heaven is what puts us to an end. And actually, this is a teaching that is done through Alpha, and we've done it lately in the prison, and even in the latest chapter of Grace, the Forbidden Gospel. The law had its purpose. And the law's purpose, according to the Scripture, was that every man's tongue would be stilled and that we all would be found guilty before God. And I actually put this out there because I related it to the laws that we have today. And I'm not advocating, but I want in the way of education. Do you know that there were a time in America that opium was legal? You could have opium with you. You could be drinking it in an elixir. You could be smoking it. Nobody would do anything. It wasn't wrong until the law was created. And there was a time when marijuana was legal. Nobody did anything about it. It was not a problem until the law was created, isn't it? Now, like I say, I'm not advocating. I'm just letting you know what the law does is it makes you a criminal. If you're using what used to be legal and now it's illegal. The law, sin, took the occasion of the law and got its power thereby. If it wasn't for the law, you wouldn't know it was wrong. You wouldn't know it was bad. That's scriptural, okay? If it was not for the law, you wouldn't know it was bad. When the law was laid down, it made sin and the power of sin increase so that we could realize the purpose of the law was this, to bring us to a point of death. To say, you know what, I can't do this right. I need help. I need somebody to save me. When you accept the Savior, you've come to the point of death, and God takes you out from under the law. The law has done its job. It's brought you to the point of death. You've given up. You've asked Christ for help, and now you get to live under grace. Taking in the Spirit. Old Testament, the Spirit would come upon people, and they would do great things. The Spirit would come upon people with their faith, and the Spirit would come upon them, and they would be enabled by God to do things. New Testament, God says this, Jesus said this to his disciples, don't freak out, I'm going to go away. I'm going to be seated at the right hand of the Father, and another helper, one just like me, will come. And does anybody know where he's going to be? He will live in you and guide you. And when the Spirit comes upon you, you shall do greater things than I. My own little Reader's Digest version, but that's what it reads. When the Spirit comes upon you, when you allow the Spirit to come in to live and guide in you, you will do great things. The scripture where return of Christ returned for his church. I want to talk about the church for a minute. Is the church a building? No. Is it an organization? No. The church is people. You are the church. Bob said something about going out and being part of the church. And I don't want you to get the picture of being part of the church, the organized organization. I want you to understand that you are part of the body of Christ that reaches out to love somebody else. You have a job as being a member of Christ's body. I can relate this to the other scripture. The eye has a purpose, but the eye would be very limited in its view if it was not for the feet. And the feet have their purpose as well. And the hand has their purpose, and the ear has their purpose. So I'm not saying you are the entire body, but you have a purpose within the body. You might be the eye, you might be the foot. That's what God wants you to understand. He's returning for his church. When his Spirit comes upon you, it's pictured as a wedding, with the church being his beautiful bride. I like the term beauty. I like the term that God loves us. That God looks at us and he's proud of us. Now, I would be willing to bet, if not, maybe you've come here for a long time and you're starting to get it, but for the longest time in your life, you might not have been very proud of yourself. Honestly, on the outside, I'm proud that I could pull that off of an accomplishment, but in the long run, are you assured that you're awesome? I'm not awesome. You should see the looks on your mugs. I'm awesome. You should see it. But everyone is like, I'm awesome? God says this, you are my beloved child in whom I am well pleased. In God's eyes, you are a 10. You are already perfected. You're in the process. But if you think you're anything less than a 10, then you're not trusting what God says about you. I would say, listen to his Spirit. See what's going on there. Are you trusting what God says? Could be that you don't have the oil in you, too. Possible. Possible. Let's go down through the list. The wise virgins took oil for their lamps so they would be ready for the arrival. Bottom line about this service here, are you ready for the arrival? If Christ should show up tomorrow? If you should take your last breath today? Because the scripture says this, if you were to take your last breath, you'll be in God's presence. When you take your last breath. I know people teach about purgatory. They teach about a sleeping area and a time. The Bible says if you should take your last breath, you'll be in his presence. If you're prepared. And it's not a fear factor. It's not about frightening you, because what God wants to do is lay his spirit into you so you can start to experience heaven now. And sometimes we don't feel like we're in heaven. It's because of what you're believing. Be ready for the arrival of the bridegroom. The five foolish virgins, and I don't like to use the word foolish, but it's in the Bible that way, didn't take any oil. Those who said, you know what, I got nothing to worry about. That's all hocus pocus. Whatever. I lived there for 34 years too. I don't need God. I got this. You should see how I ran my life. It was awesome. Not, it wasn't awesome. I ran my life right into the ground. And there are people who run their lives differently, who run their lives up onto the top of a mountain. But let me ask you this. Without faith in Christ, when it's all said and done, what did they achieve? See, because when I die and when they die, we're all going to lose the same thing, everything. We're going to leave it all behind. There was a story I got to tell you. You probably heard it. It's an old one. But the guy who got to heaven and he had gold bars in his pockets. St. Peter said, you can't come in with stuff. There's nothing you can bring in. He says, I just want to take these gold bars. Can I bring these? And he looked at him. He said, pavement? Why would you want pavement? The streets are lined with gold. It's just stuff. The oil represents being prepared. The wise virgins went into the wedding with the bridegroom. The other ones were told, I didn't know you. I knew you not. We spoke about this just last week. How many people know George Washington? Come on, show of hands. You know George Washington? Nobody? You know George Washington? Yeah? Where does he live? See, you know about George Washington, but we don't know George Washington, right? Some of us might know somebody famous. Maybe we hung out at a party with him. You know, I shook hands with him, but did you really get to know him? And this is something Mark and I had a conversation. It's funny how you get to know people. And at first, everything's real good, but then you get to know people. And you start backing away going, wait a minute. They think they're so this, and you think you're so that. And I know that they, and you start making judgments, and you start finding out some people aren't safe, and some people are good, and some people aren't good. But you got to know them. And Jesus gets to know you, and he accepts you the way you are. With all your flaws. That's the cool thing I think about God with me. He accepts me and I'm a mess. I'm an absolute mess. Most people would reject me, but he loves me. That's awesome. And God says he's well pleased with me, and that's awesome too. So I start to believe by that fact that I'm okay. I'm awesome. If God says I'm a 10, I'm going to start believing him. I want to start walking in that. And when I believe it and I'm secure in his love, then I can start to care about somebody other than me. And worrying about what you think about me. I've been in relational training a lot, and you know, you go into a room and you think everybody's looking at you, but Dale Carnegie, Zig Ziglar, don't worry about what they think. They're so worried about what everybody else thinks about them, they don't even know you're there. And that's a good enough reason, but it's really not enough. I want to be assured that I'm okay. I don't care what other people think anymore. I don't know if you've noticed or not. I care about other people, but I'm not really swayed by what your opinion is when I'm free. So the five that weren't prepared, they weren't allowed to enter. Jesus instructed us to be on the lookout for his return and to be prepared. A couple of notes I took here. Short term is temporary. Anything short term is temporary. So how long is temporary? Temporary is anything less than eternal. Because even if it lasts 40 years, when it ends, it's done. 40 years can be temporary, can it? So anything that's not temporary is eternal. Bob used the term temporal, of the flesh, temporary. Everything I'm doing for myself is temporary. Everything God's doing for me is eternal. The letter of law brings death. The spirit brings life. There's a certain glory in administering the law, the Bible says. I get to stand up here and put myself on a pedestal, and I get a certain glow while I'm spewing out the law. But it goes on, it says, how much more glory is there in administering the Spirit? Administering. Don't we use that term with medication? Administering a healing agent. Administering the oil of God. Administering the Spirit. Because the Spirit brings eternal life. And how much more glory is there? And guess what? It isn't about me. It's His glory. He gets glorified justly and rightly because He's the one who deserves it. So here, while we're waiting for Christ to return, it says this. We're going to focus on Him. And here's a key. We're going to allow His Spirit to move us and guide us. There's a scripture that Bob put here, and it's great. Be not drunk as with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, this is not about drinking and not drinking. It's not what it's intended for. It's an example. It's about control. If you're drunk with wine, who's in control? The wine. It's about control issue, okay? It's not about don't drink. I've heard it preached that way. It's not the point. It's about control. Don't be out of control. Be filled with the Spirit. Be filled. Does that mean you're doing it? Or does it mean you're allowing it to occur? You look so familiar. I'll figure it out in a minute. Be filled. Allow yourself to be filled with the Spirit. It's your choice to invite. It's your choice to slam the door. Be filled with the Spirit. And the other scripture says this, be filled with the Spirit always. Allow God to lead always. There is therefore right now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Have you made a mistake today? Did you sin? See, we look at that sin thing. What can I get away with? That's what you're doing, really. You got saved. Well, am I allowed to do this? Am I allowed to do that? I'm not sure if I'm ready to give it all up. Can I do this? Can I not do that? Am I supposed to? Am I not supposed to? You're looking for loopholes. But there's no condemnation. When you make a mistake, you don't have to beat yourself up anymore. Who do you think is condemning you? The one who came to save you? That doesn't even make sense. If I step out here and I twist my ankle and somebody dials 911 and they come out, they don't shoot me and put me out of my misery. They came to rescue me, not to finish me off. See, it doesn't even make sense in the flesh. But in the Spirit, who do you think is condemning you? The one who came to save you? That doesn't make sense. Stop believing that lie. Christ came to set you free. Christ came to take you out of bondage. He came to remove guilt and shame. So if you're in guilt and shame, you might be under the wrong teaching. It's not about guilt and shame. It's about being set free. It's about finding peace. It's about being able to love, being assured that you're okay. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, it's not saying be careful you walk according to the flesh. Be careful you walk according to the Spirit. It says you do not walk according to the flesh anymore. You walk according to the Spirit. And here's my thought. When Jesus came into town on that donkey, I didn't want to say ass in church. When he came into town on the donkey, the centurions, the guards said, you silence those people. And Jesus' response was this. If I silence the people, the rocks will cry out. In other words, God's will is going to get done. If you've invited the Spirit in you, His will be done. Your option is this. You can go peacefully, or you can go kicking and clawing. My firsthand experience, it's easier to go peacefully. I look at the arrest records all the time on St. Lucie County, and you got to scroll down the page, and the photo comes up first before the charges. And you can tell the ones who resisted. There's usually a big bandage and a puffy eye and a cut on the lip. Go peacefully. But there's no reason to not go peacefully with God. You're not going to be destroyed. He's not hurting you. There was a lesson that we did with John Glenn, and I want you to hear this. We did it in class, too, last week. I want you to hear this. When we're asking God to remove our shortcomings, it's not like He's pulling out a splinter. It's not going to hurt. He's not going to injure us, okay? He wants to remove it, but he works from the inside out. You ever notice about a splinter that we're made awesome? We have a system that comes into play. If you get a little splinter and you don't take it out, what happens to it? It festers up and it gets a big old pimple in there, and then what happens? It builds up so much pressure, it pushes it out by itself. Now it's uncomfortable in the meantime, isn't it, Doug? Well, why don't you go ask somebody for help? You don't want them digging around hurting you more, do you? Okay? God isn't going to hurt you more. He's going to allow it to heal faster. He's going to displace it with his spirit. The stuff that's not of him, as he expands within you, he displaces it. It's not hurtful. It's helpful. It's not harmful. Let me correct that. It's not harmful. It might be uncomfortable for a little while, but it's not harmful. Difference between hurt and harm. It hurts to go to a dentist, but he's not harming you. He's helping you. It might hurt to deal with some of your stuff, but it's never going to harm you when God's handling it. And he wants you to become everything he wants you to become by faith, not by works. And then he'll allow you to do the work when you're prepared. You're probably going to go through a little wilderness experience where you feel like, I'm doing everything I can for God, and he just doesn't get it. And you'll feel frustrated. And God will say, are you sure you're doing that for me? Or you think that might be about you? If your arm gets a little crook in it from doing this all the time, chances are that might not be about him. He's not getting the glory. So the timeout for the trip in, the very bottom. Oh, important point. Bob said something about those other, the foolish virgins. They were told to go out and get it for yourself. Go purchase your oil for yourself. See, we can share the experience of God. We can share what it's like to have the oil, but go get your own. Sounds kind of harsh, but it's the reality. You're supposed to work out your own salvation. God says that. You work out your own salvation. You go to God. It's a personal thing. And I've heard it put this way with married couples, and it sounds harsh as well. But God will take you to the cross alone. Your wife might lead you to it, but when you have that experience, it's between you and him. Between you and him. It's going to be a very personal experience for you. I don't know what it's going to take for you to come to the cross. I'm not going to put the fear factor in you and say, if you don't turn right now, you're going to burn in hell, because that doesn't work. God is a God of attraction. He wants to set you free. He wants you to be freed from pain. He wants you to be freed from guilt. He wants you to be freed from shame, guilt, condemnation. Why don't we want that? Bottom line, I can do this on my own. And I think God's response is this: okay, let me know when you're done. It's all right with me. If you want to keep on trying, son, daughter, go ahead. When you get done, let me know when you give up, and I'll help you. I'm here. I'm not going to reject you. Keep on trying. It's okay. I'm not going to get mad. But be better if you didn't. Just a thought. So time out for the trip in. Am I prepared for the union with the bridegroom? Am I ready? Only you can answer that for you. Are you ready? Do you know beyond the shadow of a doubt? If not, my thought is this: if you're still breathing, it's not too late. It's not too late to ask to be filled with the Spirit. God, I think I had an inkling. I know I stood up when I was 6 years old in the church and I said the magic words, but you know, since then, it really wasn't much of a decision on my part to follow you. God, I want you in my life. Let's do it your way. And God will make the difference. So as we close up, I'm going to have a prayer. And we don't have the anointing oils with us. If somebody does, that's good. But the anointing of the oil was a signification, an outward display that I accepted this Christ life. And if you've accepted that Christ life, that's great news. We don't have to put on a big show, because God will start to work in you, and God will show himself strongly in your life as you allow him to lead. Father, this morning as we close up, Kat and Doug will be setting up for communion directly back to the back in front of me behind the cameras. And God, it's my biggest desire, God, that your oil would fill the hearts of every person here, that they would understand that they are the church. They are a part of the body that ministers in this world as you lead. God, as your Spirit comes over us, as your Spirit leads us and guides us, firstly, God, fill us. Fill us to overflowing. Fill us with your love. Fill us with your acceptance. Assure us by your Spirit that we are everything that you say we are, so we don't have to run around hungry and thirsty for our own needs. God, we can start to meet the needs of others because our needs are already handled. God, we love you for that. And we love you for so much more, just the opportunity to be here with you. But God, the bigger opportunity to serve, to reach out to others, and to share your love and help the oil flow. God, we thank you for this opportunity. We praise you that you do the work. In Jesus' name, amen. So as you have communion, we'll got a couple other songs here, and we'll close up. Be sure to sign up, plug in with Jim back there if you want to go on the walk on Thanksgiving, if you want to do the men's prayer breakfast. If you want information about the parade, it's up here at this offering table. There's another offering table back there if you haven't got a bulletin. And we're always looking for ways to reach out into the community. If you have a heart to serve, come see me. We'll set up a time. There's daytime hours at the church office all the time where you can plug in and start doing a class or a teaching. If you have something you want to do, we want people to step up as leaders who are prepared.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Smoking hot wife up to sing a duet with me. This is from God to you, by the way, this song. Listen to the words. Thank you. you come. You don't have to worry, 'cause I'm here. Don't need to suffer, 'cause I'm here. So hold on, 'cause I'm coming. Just hold on, 'cause I'm coming. Just hold on, don't you worry, I'm coming. Just hold on, 'cause I'm coming. Reach out for me, yeah. Hey, hey.
done for the Lord.
Amen.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. All done. Everybody have a great Sunday. Remember, reach out to somebody this holiday season. Show them the love of God. God loves you. So do we. What? All done.